Good morning. My name is Eric Toensmeier. I'm a writer and trainer on perennial cropping systems and an appointed lecturer at Yale University. And my co-author is Rafter Ferguson, who's a PhD candidate at the University of Illinois. Our presentation is Perennial Agriculture Now, a Global Review of Existing Perennial Staple Crops by Climate Region and Nutrient Profile. And I'd like to thank the organizers for making it possible for me to be here electronically for health reasons. So why are we interested in existing perennial staple crops? There has been some really fantastic work done by many of the people in this room making the case for perennializing annual staple crops and the remarkable benefits of carbon sequestration, soil building, reversing land degradation, water quality, and other multiple impacts that perennial agriculture can have. And in that effort, I think we've to some degree neglected the existing perennial staple crops that already are have been developed and are being cultivated in various places around the world. So in an effort to remedy that gap, here we present the beginnings of an analysis of perennial staple crops, looking at species which are perennial, that is, they live for multiple years and are not destroyed by harvest. So we have multiple years of harvest. We're emphasizing staple crops, the carbohydrates, fats, and proteins that provide the basic human diet. I'm primarily emphasizing crops which are already cultivated or domesticated in some part of the world. And on this table, we're looking at the yield of 66 of those perennial staple crops for which we were able to find yield data. Note that the x-axis is on a logarithmic scale. We've divided climate in terms of temperature and humidity, and some crops appear in more than one climate type in some cases. The quality and format of the data is highly variable. This is really just a coarse-grained snapshot of the available data for the global situation. For crops where only a single yield value is reported, that's plotted as a point, whereas when a range is reported, we plotted the mean as a point and the range as a transparent bar. The colors correspond to macronutrient profiles on the x-axis. And I've gone and done an analysis of global staples, mostly annual staples, to generate these five basic categories of staple crops, which we'll look at a little bit later on, but that's based on an analysis of 50 or so staples, looking at what categories they fall into in terms of percentages of protein and oil. And as you can see, we have many strong candidates, especially in the humid tropics. We have a high diversity of crops and very competitive yields. And the drier and colder you go, there's a gradient where there are lower and lower yields and less crops available. Here we can see we've reviewed 189 perennial staple crops, and we're looking at their status of development. So in the top pie chart there, we're looking at the full 189 crops. Ranging from global crop, which would be things like bananas and chestnuts that are globally traded, and the FAO stat website, the Food and Ag Organization, lists them as bringing in over $1 billion a year in global trade. Minor global crops are traded or grown globally but have less value or are marketed less. Regional crops are cultivated but only in one region, and then we have some wild staples that have been important food for people for generations, and people still eat them, some historic crops that have been abandoned for one reason or another, and some new crops, typically which are historic staples and now being cultivated. So the top chart shows that distribution, and you can notice that over three quarters are already cultivated, at least as regional crops. On the bottom left, we see the crops for which we do have yield data, and again we have lots of regional and minor global and some global crops. And on the bottom right we have an additional 123 species for which no yield data was found, and over three quarters of these our regional crops. Some of these may be better performers than those in the pie chart on the left, and this would be a good area for further study. So let's take a look at the categories of perennial staple crops that we've come up with. The first one is the basic starch crops. These have between 0 and 5% protein and 0 and 5% oil. They're similar to, they're in the same category as contemporary staple crops like cassava, sweet potato, and taro. We have some global examples like banana, plantain, and breadfruit. And the example we wanted to highlight of this is the air potato, Dioscorea bulbifera, which is a perennial vine. It produces tubers on the vine, and there are both sort of wild, there is a wild, weedy, poisonous set of varieties, and there are cultivated, non-poisonous, much less aggressive varieties. It's a very, very interesting crop. It produces high yields up to 19 tons per hectare, and definitely something worth further exploration. And here we can see the yields, the comparative yields, of various perennial and annual staple crops. In this case, actually, these are perennials grown as annuals, our comparison crops. Those in blue are our annual competitor crops, and those in black text, excuse me, are our perennials. And as you can see, in this case, and in tropical climates, which is mostly where these basic starch crops are grown, the perennials have very competitive yields. Although, of course, comparing the weight of fruits and tubers and dry starches and so on is not a precise art by any stretch of the imagination, but at least gives us a sense that, yes, there's definitely very real potential for the use of basic starch plants to come from an increasing amount of perennial crops. Our next category is the balanced carbohydrates. These have between 5 and 15% protein or 5 to 15% oil. This would be your crops like maize and rice and wheat and so on. Potatoes, critical important staple crops. And our only global perennials in this category are chestnut and carob. Our sample crop to take a look at is mesquite, which is a truly remarkable crop. There's many species ranging from quite cold tolerant to highly tropical for arid and semi-arid climates. And it's the pods which are eaten. They're both a historic staple for thousands of years, particularly in the Americas, and also now under increasing cultivation. There are grafted orchards planted out in Bolivia and Argentina, for example. So we're going to see more and more of mesquite as a future crop. And looking at the yields of mesquite, we can see we have reported yields of 10 to as much as 60 tons per hectare, mostly in wild plants. And we have a number of other very strongly competitive balanced carbohydrate crops, the peach palm, Tahitian chestnut, and others, which compare very favorably to our annual staple crops in this category. Moving along to the protein crops, these would have 16% or more protein and less than 15% oil. These would be analogs to your phaseolus, beans, chickpeas, lentils, and cowpeas. And we currently really have no globally traded perennials in this category. There are some varieties of pigeon pea, which are perennial, which have been developed in India. But my understanding is that most of the pigeon pea material that's traded around the world is really the very short-lived types of pigeon peas. And the crop, the highlight here is the chachafruto or basul. It's a tree bean from the Andes with absolutely mind-boggling yields, really absolutely incredible yields. It's a species of tropical highlands, sort of somewhat humid to sort of on the edge of semi-arid tropical highlands. Very, very remarkably productive species. As you can see here, the reported yields are 13 tons per hectare, which is truly remarkable when compared to the other annual and even the other perennial members of this category, which includes a number of interesting perennials. The pole types of runner and lima beans are perennial in the proper climates, and we do have some perennial pigeon peas, as well as some other interesting species. The Australian acacias for extremely dry climates would be an excellent example. So again, we can see some strong competitors, particularly in tropical climates. Now we have the category of protein and oil crops. These have over 16% protein and over 16% oil. These would be the soybean, our perennial soybean or peanut. For that matter, the cheeseburger is in this category. The bacon cheeseburger would be in this category. So we have a number of nut crops that are already global perennials in this category, including some very nice temperate and Mediterranean species. The species we're choosing to highlight here, the underutilized species, is the perennial agouti or colocynth, Citrullus colocynthus. This is a, around the world, there are watermelon seeds and pumpkin seeds that are very important staples for people. Agouti is a category of African cucurbit seeds, which includes various members of various genera. In this case, Citrullus colocynthus, which is a cultivated species with remarkable yields for semi-arid and extremely arid tropical and subtropical climates. The yields on that particular species are up to 6.7 tons per hectare, which is quite remarkable. We have a number of other underutilized species in this category, as well as some of the more commonly grown ones like almonds and hazelnuts. Particularly worth mentioning is the inche, Caryodendron ornicosensi, which is an South American, sort of a Amazonian type species that has the fruits of which have been extrapolated to 6 to 15 tons per hectare, which is quite impressive. Although we know that extrapolating from a few trees to a large area certainly isn't anything you want to base your whole new food strategy on. But again, we have some very competitive species giving similar or superior yields to annual protein oil staple crops. Moving on to the oil crops, these would have less than 15% oil and more than 16% or more oil. These would be our canolas, our poppy seeds, our butter, and we already have a number of very strong performing global perennials in this area, including both extracted oils like palm oil, but also fruits and nuts like macadamia or coconut or avocado, which are consumed as fruits and nuts that happen to be high in oil. The species we're profiling in this case is a sea buckthorn or sea berry, Hippophae rhamnoides. Recently potentially renamed Eliagnus rhamnoides, excuse me, which is a nitrogen-fixing shrub for extremely cold climates, USDA zone 2 or below. So this can be grown in Siberia and northern Saskatchewan and Manitoba and other very cold and dry areas. And it produces high yields of a very oil-rich fruit. And in my analysis of global fruits, this was really the only species for cold climates that was high in oil. So it's very exciting to see that. And you can see here that the yields of that are around 10 to 14 tons per hectare of fruit, which yields somewhere in the neighborhood of 600 kilograms of oil per hectare. So these oily fruits and nuts can have very impressive yields. Some of them are already pretty important world staples. Others are new and coming along, like the African butterfruit and some others. And here we have some true oil plants that are really expressed oil plants. And here we can see actually that while African oil palm certainly is doing better than all of the other ones, we have some very impressive yields from the annuals. And unfortunately, what we're lacking is quantities of oil expelled from the fruits and nuts of the previous slide. We really don't have a whole lot of data on that, so I suspect that some of them will be certainly doing better than a ton per hectare of oil, but we don't have good data on that at the moment. And it's interesting to compare these existing perennial staples to perennial grains. And really, in this case, we're just looking at the minor global and regional crops. We already know about the truly global crops, and we'll leave out the undomesticated wild staples. In terms of crop readiness, these have a big advantage. Perennial grains, really, with the very few exceptions, aren't yet ready for implementation, whereas many of these perennial staples are already grown on a fairly large scale. So they're much readier in terms of domestication and some of the techniques of production being worked out. And carbon sequestration is generally higher with woody plants, and many of these perennial staples woody plants, so they will do better than perennial grains in terms of carbon sequestration. However, there are a number of drawbacks in this comparison. Perennial grains have the advantage of being able to use existing production and harvest equipment and processing infrastructure. Really, our whole food system is already built around these annual staple crops, which are being perennialized, which also have marketability and familiarity. People know them and know how to eat them and know how to cook with them and are prepared to buy them already. Whereas this can be more of a barrier with some of these underutilized perennial staples. They may require new equipment, new processing infrastructure, new kind of shipping techniques, and that may be a requirement to build markets and increase familiarity with them. So I really see them as complementary strategies. In terms of our recommendations, we're looking to, we'd like to see greatly expanded production of these shovel-ready crops, these crops which are already being implemented, which are already cultivated. Competitive yielding perennial crops should be grown on a wider scale. And we really see that as a win-win mitigation strategy, sequestering carbon and providing food. And in the case of some of these which are less familiar crops, we may not be able to get people to eat them quickly, but we can certainly feed them to livestock. And a third of our annual grain acreage globally is being used to feed livestock. So it certainly makes sense to feed livestock perennials that come from carbon sequestering sources. There's a need to facilitate a global germplasm exchange, both of the crops in the first place and also of the improved varieties within those. We'd like to really emphasize a participatory crop approach like that of Richard Leakey's Living with the Trees of Life, which is a fantastic book. And we feel like there's an opportunity to tap into the international agroforestry community, which has come up with some really, which has a huge adoption and implementation infrastructure already in place that we could take advantage of. So you'd be very welcome to contact Rafter and myself regarding the article. Again, thanks very much for having us, being able to have the flexibility to have us there electronically. And I can't really take your questions, but perhaps you might ask a few to each other, and I hope that the day goes very well. Thank you.